Welcome to our annual awards ceremony. This afternoon, we will present awards across a wide spectrum of science, and it will be interesting and I think inspiring to hear about some of the truly major discoveries and developments for which these awards are granted. The whole competition is rather competitive, and we have selection committees and review committees set up for every single award. And as we go along today, we will interview or request a member, a representative member, or the selection committee chair to introduce the award winner herself or himself. So we will begin in just a minute. The ceremony is being broadcast, webcast, around the country. We alerted NAS members and a number of other people to the webcast, so a lot of people will be watching from distant places. So be on good behavior. First, let me announce a new award this year. It's the National Academy of Sciences Award for Scientific Discovery, and it will be presented for the first time at this ceremony. The award was established by the Research Corporation for Science Advancement, of which many of you know. You've participated in its programs over the years, and the Frederick Gardner Cottrell Foundation in honor of former Research Corporation President John Schaefer. And I'd like to ask the following people just stand to be recognized. John Schaefer and his family are with us this afternoon. Thank you. And Robert Shelton, Dr. Shelton, who's and Lyle Bootman from the Frederick Gardner Cottrell Foundation. I'd like to ask them. Thank you. And I think I missed Lyle Bootman. Right. Please stand also. Thank you. From the Cottrell Foundation. Also, earlier this morning, at a major meeting of the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences editors and editorial board, they recognized winners of prizes across six fields of science. I'm going to ask the winners to stand. They've been recognized this morning by their peers. I'll read the titles of those papers and the individuals and ask however many of the authors are here to please stand. First of all, in physical and mathematical sciences, Seth Burgess, Samuel Baring, Xuzhong Chen for the paper, A High Precision Timeline for Earth's Most Severe Extinction. Awesome. Congratulations. Across the biological sciences, Anthony Vaccarelli, Kerr Newman, and Kyoshi Mizuuchi for the paper, A Propagating ATPase Gradient Drives Transport of Surface-Confined Cellular Cargo. There's the photo op. Thank you. For the engineering and applied sciences, the winning authors are Sungwoo Lee, Chris Layton, and Frank S. Bates for the paper, Sphericity and Symmetry Breaking in the Formation of Frank-Casper Phases from One Component Materials. Thank you. In several of these cases, the cover photo and image on the proceedings issue reflects the paper as it appeared. In the biomedical sciences, Yara Oren, Mark B. Smith, Nathan Johns, Millie Kaplan-Zeevi, Devorah Biren, Eliora Ron, Zhuka Korander, Harris Wong, Eric Alm, and Tal Puko. For the paper, Transfer of Non-Coding DNA Drives Regulatory Rewiring in Bacteria. And the quiz on this paper will be for each of you to resketch that diagram. Okay, Behavioral and Social Sciences. The paper was entitled Neural and Cognitive Characteristics of Extraordinary Attention, or Altruists, sorry. Abigail Marsh, Sarah Stoikos, Kristen Brethel-Horwitz, Paul Robinson, John Van Meter, and Elise Cardinal. Any stand? Thank you. Congratulations. Congratulations. And in the applied biological, agricultural, and environmental sciences, the authors are Jinti Lin, Da Pan, Stephen Davis, Kyung Zhang, Kibin He, Khan Wang, David Streets, Don Wibbles, and Dabo Guan. The paper, China's International Trade and Air Pollution in the United States. The first medal that we will present today is the J. Lawrence Smith Medal, and it will be introduced by Richard W. Carlson, Chair of the Selection Committee.
The J. Lawrence Smith Medal has been awarded by the National Academy since 1888. This year, it's awarded to Hiroko Nagahara of the University of Tokyo for her work on the kinetics of evaporation and condensation processes in the earlier solar system and for her fundamental contributions to one of the most enduring mysteries in meteoritics, the origin of small igneous spherules called chondrules that make up the majority of the most important group of meteorites. Her observational studies showed that chondrules formed by remelting events and not by the direct condensation from nebular gas, and her laboratory studies define the pressure and composition of the nebular gas that was present when chondrules were being formed. As a result, her works greatly advanced our understanding of the conditions existing in the early solar nebula at the very beginning of planetesimal formation. It's my honor to present Dr. Hiroko Nagahara as the 2015 Smith Medalist.
Oh, thank you very much for the John Lawrence Smith Medal. It's a great honor for me. I'd like to thank National Academy of Sciences, the selection committee, and the friends of mine who kindly recommended me to the medal. I also thank Ikuo Kushiro, supervisor of my PhD work on the origin of chondrules in the University of Tokyo. My specific thank is to Kazuo Ozawa. Without collaboration with him for a long time, I'm not here today. My thanks are also to Bill Misson, UMFA, and Cornel Alexander of Carnegie Institution, Jeff Grossman in NASA, Ed Young in UCLA, Sasha Kratt in Hawaii, Noriko Kita in Wisconsin, Shogo Tachibana in Hokkaido University. I enjoyed the collaboration with them, and sometimes they helped me personally. I also thank many graduate students who worked with me, including Aki Takigawa and Risa Sakai. And finally, I thank my family. Thank you very much again.
Now we'll present the Mary Clark Thompson Medal, and it will be introduced by the Chair of the Selection Committee, Neil Shubin.
Susan Kidwell has opened the past as a means to think about our future. The fossil record is an over 3 billion year chronicle of life on Earth. To leverage that history and answer major questions we face today, such as how animals and plants respond to climate change, we need to assess the actual diversity and abundance of species in the distant past. With creative and rigorous approaches to the processes of fossil accumulation, Kidwell has made fundamental contributions to understanding the nature of the marine record. In putting marine paleoecology on a new and more robust footing, from deep geological time to the recent, she has helped establish critical pre-human baselines for understanding how species respond to environmental change. For these contributions, the 2015 Mary Clark Thompson Medal in Geology and Paleontology is awarded to Susan M. Kidwell.
Thank you. This is completely amazing. I've had the advantage of really inspiring and generous colleagues and many wonderful, wonderful, wonderful students to work with. I see you can see several of them here. And I've gotten a lot of good advice over the years. One piece was to be true to your rocks, meaning don't shoehorn data into a model or a theory that it doesn't really fit. Instead, just let it take you somewhere completely new. And then in the final analysis, honesty will be rewarded. A second insight was that the rock record is a lot like a child's definition of a net, and that is a lot of holes held together with string. The variation in that fabric explains to us, reveals to us how the dynamics of the Earth's surface really works, and those gaps should motivate rather than paralyze us. I mean, we all make great decisions all the time on less than complete information. Finally, a colleague at Chicago, relevant to sort of the small number of women in the physical sciences, said that the suggested that, although it's a multivariate problem, the best advice for women themselves was simply to don't marry a jerk. I didn't. quite the contrary, and that has made all the difference. Thank you very much.
The National Academy of Sciences Award in Molecular Biology will be introduced by R. Scott Hawley, Chair of the Selection Committee.
The National Academy of Science Award in Molecular Biology recognizes two achievements. The first is to make a technical advance or breakthrough that increases our ability and our vision. In fact, in this case, with Xiaowei Zhang, what she did was to pass something called the diffraction limit. She made us able to see what we had been told for all of our careers we couldn't see. She made that possible. But we also asked something more. We asked that the individual use that technique to make a major advance and contribute to our understanding of basic biology. She did that too. So on behalf of the committee, we consider it a huge honor to introduce Professor Xiaowei Zhang.
So it's a truly great pleasure and honor for me to receive this NAS Award in Molecular Biology. So I would like to thank the former and current lab members. It is their creativity and unwavering efforts that are truly instrumental for the development of STORM, a super resolution fluorescence microscopy method that we invented, and also for using STORM to make biological discoveries. So I also would like to thank the award committee members for recognizing our work, and thank you.
Let's move to the J.C. Hunsaker Award in Aeronautical Engineering. It will be introduced by Paul Bevilacqua, a member of the selection committee.
The Hunsaker Award is given in recognition of distinguished contributions to aeronautical engineering. Previous recipients have included Leroy Grumman, James McDonnell, and Donald Douglas. If anyone belongs in such august company, it is Alan Mulally, today's honoree. He is the man who led the development of Boeing's 777 aircraft, the most commercially successful wide-body aircraft of all time. Its combination of large seating capacity, long range, and fuel efficiency are unmatched by any other family of airliners. With the 777, he introduced a number of advanced technologies to the manufacture of commercial aircraft, beginning with computer-aided design and including Boeing's first digital fly-by-wire flight control system, fiber optic avionics network, glass cockpit displays, and the use of advanced materials to save weight. Designed with the future in mind, the 777 already meets the noise and emission standards planned for the next generation of airliners. Reflecting on the number of advances in this aircraft, you can appreciate how easy it was for the award committee to choose this year's recipient. I am so delighted to recognize Alan Mulally's contributions to aeronautical engineering. So for his distinguished leadership in commercial aviation, as exemplified by the development and commercialization of the Boeing 777, the Hunsaker Award is presented to Alan Mulally of the Boeing Company.
Well, I'd like to thank the National Academy of Sciences for this very special recognition. I've had the honor over the years to work with a lot of talented engineers around the world to create all of the Boeing airplanes, the 707, the 727, the 737, the 747, the 757, the 767, the 777, and the 787. So clearly I'm very old, and if it's not Boeing, you shouldn't be going. The commercial airplanes are absolutely fantastic, and maybe the neatest thing about them is they continue to get people together around our world. And I, like you, know that we get people together, that we find out we have more in common than we're different. And then usually we choose to work together for the benefit of all of us. So thank you very much for the special recognition.
The Selman A. Waxman Award in Microbiology will be introduced by Patricia Speer, Chair of the Selection Committee. Pat?
The Selman A. Waxman Award in Microbiology is given for innovative advances in this field. The 2015 Selman A. Waxman Award in Microbiology is presented to Susan Gottesman of the National Cancer Institute for transforming our understanding of post-transcriptional regulation in bacteria through mechanisms of controlled proteolysis and small RNAs. Susan, on behalf of the award committee, it's a real pleasure for me to make this award.
So it's a real honor to join the ranks of the former Waxman winners, some of whom are here, and I want to thank the nominators and the committee and the Waxman Foundation for continuing to support microbiology. I was lucky enough to be given microbe hunters when I was in about fifth grade, and that started me on a long-term love affair with bacteria and what you could do to understand biology through studies of bacteria. And I've had the luck to be part of a wonderful community of collaborators and friends and colleagues all over the world, and in particular at NIH, where we have the freedom to sort of follow our noses in unexpected directions, and some of those turn out to be productive. So over the years, I've really continued to enjoy myself, and my wish for my grandchildren and all of our granddaughters is that they get to do something that they love as much, and thank you for this award.
The National Academy of Sciences Arctowski Medal will be introduced by Jack R. Jacopi, the chair of the selection committee. Jack?
For his notable imagination in framing many of the space sciences' most basic conceptions about the solar wind and the interplanetary magnetic field and their interactions with the Earth, its magnetosphere, and other planets at the beginning of the space age. I'm going to say that I'm not young, but when I started my first postdoc, Alex Dessler was already known as one of the major contributors to the field, new field of space science. He's a pioneer in many of these areas. I'm not going to list them all. I'm a good personal friend of his, and he's going to tell you a little bit about his most recent interest, which many of you may be interested in as well, ball lightning, which is a fascinating subject. So I will, it is no accident that his 1960s vision of Earth's magnetosphere adorns the Arctowski Medal. It's on the medal. So, Alex Dessler.
First, thank you, Randy, your fine selection committee, and my brilliant graduate student, Tom Hill, who crafted the successful nomination. I thought I'd tell you a few of my connections to the Arctowski Medal. Number one, the first Arctowski medalist was Eugene Parker, one of a pair. About two decades earlier, I was a sophomore at Caltech, and Parker was my TA for electricity and magnetism. A decade later, we were co-authoring papers, some of which I'm sure got me on the stage today. Connection two. The second Arctowski medalist was Francis Johnson. A year before Sputnik was launched, I was a fresh PhD in low temperature physics, right out of graduate school, looking for a job. And I went to work with Frank Johnson in space physics. Frank gave me my start in space physics. My 1967 drawing of the Earth's magnetosphere, shown on the screen, is on the back of the Arctowski medal. It's kind of a surprise for me to find there's my drawing on the back. So anyway, I really appreciate the NAS and my being here. Thank you all very much.
The Gilbert Morgan Smith Medal will be introduced by Sabia Merchant, who's the chair of our selection committee.
The 2015 Gilbert Morgan Smith Medal is awarded to Takao Kondo of Nagoya University for demonstrating the occurrence of circadian clocks in prokaryotes, leading through genetic dissection to the discovery of the central bacterial clock genes, Chi-ABC, and to a new way of thinking about algal ecology. So this award honors Gilbert Morgan Smith, a renowned phycologist and elected to the Academy in 1948. He's the author of several textbooks, including especially the Freshwater Algae of the United States, which was published originally in 1933 and served as a Bible for algologists for several decades. The algae, including informally the cyanobacteria, the subject of Professor Kondo's research, are ecologically important organisms since they are responsible for fixing half the carbon on this planet. Indeed, the fossil fuels that we consume today are the products of millions of years of algal photosynthesis. So what are algae? The algae, in fact, are a generic name for a polyphyletic group with representatives in multiple branches of the tree of life, and they include unicellular microbes as well as multicellular organisms such as the giant kelp, whose length can reach up to 50 meters. So algal research is represented in several sections of the academy within four of the six classes, in fact. And this made it especially challenging to select a winner among the diverse and accomplished nominees that we had this year representing oceanography, environmental sciences, and fundamental microbiology. So this year's winner, Dr. Takao Kondo, is honored for the paradigm-shifting discovery in the biological clocks field that the three Chi-ABC proteins plus ATP are sufficient to sustain rhythmic oscillation of Chi-C phosphorylation for at least 10 whole days in vitro in a test tube, a true circadian oscillator in a test tube.
It is a great honor for me to be a recipient of this highly recognized medals. I am very grateful for the committee, and thank you so much. At first, I sang to Cyan Quartet with Susan Gordon and Carl Johnson and Masahiro Ishiura. 8 years, the 8 years was really enjoyable and fortunate time for me. I thank to young people who actually worked with me at Nagoya University. They always work hard and essential for the finding, and I enjoyed working with them very much. Let me mention two former Academy members, Colin Pittendrick and Woody Hastings, who actually guide me to these fascinating fields. I also mentioned many colleagues of my field now included and several Academy members. Then finally, I would like to thank to my family, Hisayo, Ayano, and Ikuno, who helped me for long years by enjoying life with me. And then, it's more important, the final thanks is to Sinococcus elongata, cyanobacteria. This creature is a really wonderful messengers from the natures to disclose the secret of the bacterial clocks. Finding the Chi genes and in vitro oscillation are really spectacular and the biggest fortune in my life. Thank you very much.
The National Academy of Sciences Award for Scientific Reviewing is going to be introduced by Gordon Hamas, Chair of the Selection Committee. Gordon.
It's a great pleasure for me to introduce the next awardee, Tom Pollard. I have known him for a long time. I won't reveal how long. I've followed his research in the field of cell motility. It has been imaginative and innovative, but not only has he carried out outstanding research, he has been an integrator of the field. He has put together a bewildering array of various parts of the literature and made sense out of a very complicated field. I should also mention that in addition to his outstanding research, Tom has followed a parallel path. I don't know if it's a motility path or not, in the field of university of administration. In my experience, it is a very rare combination for someone to exceed in both endeavors. The 2015 National Academy of Sciences Award for Scientific Reviewing, presented in the field of biochemistry, is awarded to Thomas Dean Pollard of Yale University for his published reviews tracing the history of cell motility from its beginnings, critically analyzing the biochemical reactions responsible for cellular movements, critiquing the methods and assumptions used in the field, and synthesizing the information available into creative models that have guided the development of the field.
Gordon, thank you very much. I'm not sure you should have revealed the dark side of my career here. We're here to talk about science. Let me tell you a little bit about my story. 50 years ago, I found a great scientific question to investigate, and that was to try to understand the molecular basis of cell movements. At the time, none of the molecules responsible for cell movements had been identified. And furthermore, the experts in the field questioned whether anything could be learned about cell motility using reductionist approaches. Well, they were wrong. The question has yielded dramatically to biochemical and biophysical investigation over the last five decades. And now we understand the mechanism of cell motility, which is illustrated up here, at atomic resolution and on a millisecond time scale. Quite an amazing step forward in one person's lifetime. Now, I was fortunate a second time, and that was from the very earliest days. Some editors asked me to summarize the advances in this field. And so over the last four decades, on sort of a regular basis, I've been given the opportunity with co-authors to pull together everything that was known about the field and to critique what had been done and project what needed to be done in the future. These reviews seem to have been useful because they've been cited a very large number of times. However, you're looking at the main beneficiary of these writing projects right here, because doing these reviews immersed me in the field and caused me to look at the data and critique the methods in a way that I simply couldn't have done if I hadn't been asked to summarize it for everybody else. I did not work alone. Every one of these reviews was co-authored with one of my friends. In fact, each one of the big reviews has a different co-author. And I particularly want to call out Gary Borsey, who is here somewhere in the room. Thank you, Gary, because Gary and I wrote our most influential review in 2003 together. Thank you.
The National Academy of Sciences Award in Chemical Sciences will be introduced by Emily A. Carter, a member of the selection committee. Emily?
Well, I'm going to say how long I've known Carl Leinberger. I've known him for, I think, 30 years. And I met him when I was a graduate student first, and he has been a constant in terms of being an inspiration in so many different ways. You know, one of the things that I think is important about the National Academy is that we were founded in order to serve the nation. And even though this award is being given for your incredibly beautiful science, the fact is that you can't find another chemist on the planet, I would say, that has served more selflessly than Carl. And so it's a really great pleasure, Carl, to be able to introduce you on a personal level as well. So what has Carl done? Basically, Carl has rewritten the textbooks, the chemistry textbooks, in not only quantitatively, in terms of the actual values that appear in tables associated with electron affinities, but in terms of how chemists think about molecules. And that's what chemists do, is think about molecules. So what does that mean? Well, he invented the field of negative ion molecular photoelectron spectroscopy. Now, that sounds like it's small, but in fact, it has an amazing impact on how we think about and see in our mind's eye where electrons are in molecules, which determines their behavior, their properties, and also how they change and evolve structurally, how they react how they behave dynamically. And so for the kinds of insights that he has provided by developing that field, the 2015 National Academy of Sciences Award in the Chemical Sciences is awarded to Carl Leinberger of the Joint Institute for Laboratory Astrophysics and the University of Colorado at Boulder for his development of molecular negative ion photoelectron spectroscopy and the fundamental insights into molecular electron affinities and intramolecular dynamics derived therefrom.
Well, to start with, Emily, thank you and the selection committee so much. It is really amazing to receive such a recognition for doing something that you love so much and enjoy so much that you do it with or without recognition. And we are privileged to live in a world where we see this happening. And if there's a message that I think we find, we are so lucky to be able to do things that are valuable and part of our enhancement of ourselves and others. As I look back, many people and many institutions have really played an important role in my life, and I want to identify those to you. First, let me point out the National Academy of Sciences and the National Research Council, as we know, have this incredibly vital role in analyzing, advising government, and yes, articulating to everyone in the community the methods, the values, and the promise of science. This is an obligation that we all in this room have and need to take as seriously as possible. I fully agree with Emily's comment on that. I would add, we have the best funding agencies in the world, and with criteria that set the gold standard for fairness. We could use more money, but for fairness and process. And let's put it this way. In that context, I would particularly like to recognize a couple of people. Dr. Franz Cordova, the director of the National Science Foundation, is here today, along with my chemistry colleague for many years, Fleming Krim, the NSF Assistant Director for Mathematical and Physical Sciences. Emily, there are lots of chemists who also do a lot of work. Fleming can tell you he lives without sleep. On the NAS side, John Brauman, a past Home Secretary, has been my collaborator, advisor, and mentor for longer time than John would probably like to admit. Yeah, I can see he's not admitting it, too. And at the other extreme of this spectrum, just last night, Mark Johnson from my research group was inducted into the NAS, into the section of chemistry, and I have great hope that he will continue in this tradition of serving the Academy and the National Research Council and his own science. But most important, I want to thank my wife, Kitty Edwards, who is sitting there fairly close to John. She has put up with and even encouraged with great grace the sort of obsessive life that we all lead. And without that, you're just in trouble. And so thank all of you.
Now we'll introduce the Richard Lounsbery Prize. It will be introduced by Susan G. Amara from the Selection Committee.
So the Lounsbery Award was established in 1979 to recognize by Vera Lounsbery in memory of her husband. And its aim was to recognize in alternate years French and American scientists and particularly to focus on young scientists who've made extraordinary achievements in either biology or medicine. And it's my pleasure to introduce Hopi Hoekstra, who's the winner of this year's award. Working on natural populations of deer mice as a model organism, Hopi's work really probes the molecular basis for how adaptation to novel selective pressures establishes and sustains diversity during evolution. Her tour de force transdisciplinary studies have illuminated a fundamental mechanism by which complex behaviors can evolve through multiple genetic changes, each affecting distinct behavioral models within the genome. On behalf of the Richard Lounsbery Award Committee, it's my pleasure to present the 2015 Richard Lounsbery Award to Hopi Hoekstra.
First, I'd like to thank the National Academy and the selection committee, especially Susan. I'm truly grateful for this tremendous honor and very proud to see evolutionary genetics represented here. I would also like to thank my colleagues who nominated me. What an honor to be nominated by those who I consider my scientific heroes. Most importantly, I'd like to thank all the brilliant, creative, dedicated, and hardworking collaborators, postdocs, and students with whom I've had the pleasure to work with in the lab and in the field, in the past and in the present. I'm very lucky to be a part of such an extraordinary team. And finally, I want to thank my family, my dad, who is here in the front row, no less, and my mom and my husband and son who are watching online, for all your encouragement and support over the years. Thank you very much.
The William O. Baker Award for Initiatives in Research is going to be introduced by Ian M. Johnstone, who chairs one of our Academy sections, who's made this selection. Ian?
The William O. Baker Award for Initiatives in Research also recognizes innovative young scientists and encourages research likely to lead toward new capabilities for human benefit. The 2015 award is in the field of statistics and machine learning. On behalf of the selection committee chaired by Michael Jordan, I'm delighted to present the award to Benjamin Recht of the University of California, Berkeley. Ben's research explores the intersection of convex optimization, mathematical statistics, and machine learning. He's very well known for his work on matrix completion, the statistical problem of filling in the missing entries of a partially observed matrix when that matrix has a small rank and the unobserved entries are missing at random. The problem arises in a variety of real-world domains, including recommendation systems. Recht's work provides the underlying theory for optimization-based methodology for building these systems. The citation says, "For his significant contributions at the confluence of optimization, signal processing, and statistics, including seminal work on matrix completion." Ben.
Well, I'd like to thank the committee and the Academy for this amazing honor. Very humbled right now. I would like to thank my parents who are here in the audience, and I'd also like to thank my wife who is watching on webcast with our son, who we've trained to say, "Mommy, you're beautiful and doing an excellent job." I'd like to thank all of the brilliant scientists with whom I've had the privilege to collaborate. I know mathematical sciences are typically portrayed as a solitary endeavor, but for me, it's the social aspects that are the most inspiring and invigorating. And out of all these collaborators, I'd especially like to thank Stephen Wright. Without Steve's just constant support, mentorship, and advocacy, there's no way I would be here today. So thank you all again.
There are two Trolin Research Awards, and Nancy G. Kanwisher will introduce them. She is the chair of the selection committee. Nancy?
Hi. Gives me great pleasure to present the Trolin Award to two inspiring young scientists who beautifully exemplify the deepest work on the human mind and brain. bringing together the rich insights that come from the study of human behavior with the formal power of computational theory. And in very different ways, these two scientists have taught us much about what a mind is, how it works, how it develops, and how it learns. So the first will go to Lisa Feigenson of the Johns Hopkins University for her meticulous investigations of the origins and early development of representations of objects and numbers. Her research on cognition in infancy illuminates the foundation of young children's mathematical reasoning and learning.
Thank you. It is such an honor to be standing here with all of you today. I think we can all agree that doing science is one of the most thrilling activities that any of us will be lucky enough to take part in our lifetime. If we're honest, we can also agree that doing science is sometimes exhausting and dispiriting and peppered with occasional rejection and criticism, which I think is why recognizing individual people, as you're doing today, is so powerful in reminding us that we're not alone in the lab, but we're all in this together trying to understand something about the world. So thank you for that. Nancy, thank you for that reminder, and to the National Academy of Sciences and to the Trolland family for making this possible. I'd like to thank my intellectual family, the undergraduates, the graduate students, the postdocs whose work this award really recognizes. Thank you to my mentors, my amazing mentors who inspire me daily, Susan Carey and Elizabeth Spelke. Thank you to my partner in all things, science and life, Justin Halberta. You're amazing. I'd just like to say thank you as well to two last people, my parents, Vivian and Jerry, who in every way made it possible for me to be standing here today. Thank you.
The other recipient of the Trolland Award today is Yael Niv of Princeton University, and she's receiving the award for her studies at the confluence of theory and experiment that illuminate the behavioral and biological foundations of learning and decision-making. Yael?
I'd like to thank the National Academy of Sciences, and especially Nancy Kanwisher, for seeking my nomination for this award. I'd also like to thank all my mentors and collaborators, past and present, in particular, my mentors Peter Dayan, Jonathan Cohen, and Daphne Joel, my collaborator Jeff Schoenbaum, my wonderful postdoctoral researchers, students, and research assistants from whom I learned so much, my family who has supported me and supported my career throughout the years, and last but not least, my personal mentor, collaborator, and husband, Nathaniel Daw. It's a special honor to be receiving this award in experimental psychology as a computational neuroscientist and psychologist. Until quite recently, saying that you build computational models for a living was a really good way to end that conversation very quickly. So it's been a special privilege to witness computational modeling ascend to its now prominent and well-recognized role in helping us understand behavior, cognition, and the mind. Thank you.
The William and Catherine Estes Award will be introduced by David R. Mayhew, Chair of the Selection Committee. David?
The Estes Award goes to Scott Sagan of Stanford University for his pioneering theoretical and empirical work addressing the risks of nuclear possession and deployment and the causes of nuclear proliferation. The Estes Award fits Sagan to a T. Specifically, it's supposed to be given for advancing our understanding of issues relating to the risk of nuclear war. And Sagan has changed the way we think about the risk. We think about the risk of having nuclear weapons. In his book, The Limits of Safety, he draws out a body of theory called normal accidents theory to illuminate that risk. Bad stuff can happen, or at least it doesn't seem to be a trivial risk. Accidents in the realm of deployment and otherwise cannot be ruled out, he argues in an exhaustive analysis. Also, Sagan has helped to frame the study of nuclear proliferation among nations. Why do they do it? And these days, what with Iran and North Korea and the rest, it's hard to think of a more important topic.
I want to thank the nominators and the committee for the honor of receiving this award and my many collaborators and my family who have permitted me to do the work necessary. I'm particularly thrilled to receive the Estes Award, for it recognizes not only scholarly achievement, but also the application of scholarship to a critically important policy problem, reducing nuclear risks. And it's fitting that the National Academy has an award of this nature, because the Academy, after all, was created in 1863 in the midst of the American Civil War. And it's among its very first studies commissioned by the US Navy was to investigate how to prevent the corrosion on the bottom of the new ironclad ships that the Union Navy used so effectively. With three new nuclear weapon states emerging since the end of the Cold War, a continuing crisis in the Ukraine, and the spread of nuclear energy facilities to many new countries around the world, which creates latent nuclear weapons risks, we today need more scientists, social scientists, and engineers to develop new ideas and to prevent the corrosion of the international organizations, the deterrent capabilities, and the arms control agreements that we have created in the past to help manage global nuclear risk. Thank you.
The National Academy of Sciences Award for Chemistry and Service to Society will be introduced by Peter J. Stang, a member of Section 14, our chemistry section. Peter?
The 2015 National Academy of Sciences Award for Chemistry and Service to Society is awarded to Bruce D. Roth of Genentech for his discovery, synthesis, and commercial development of atorvastatin, Lipitor, the most successful cholesterol-lowering medicine in history, which has extended the lifespan of millions of people worldwide. I'm quite convinced there are quite a few of us in this auditorium who benefit from Lipitor, myself included. I can think of no greater service to society than extending our lifespan. Thank you, Dr. Roth.
I want to thank the Academy and Peter and the selection committee and the nominators for selecting me for this incredible award. It really is humbling when I look at the list of those who have received this award before me. It really is a who's who's list of chemistry, as I'm really appreciative of it. It takes a lot of people to bring a drug to market, so I also like to thank all those many patients and people who worked on Lipitor over the years. I also need to thank my family. I think of those of us who are scientists, I think we know the sacrifices that our families make to allow us to do what we do. And so I want to thank my wife, Michelle, and my children, my dad especially, for their support over the years. I work in an industry where we employ some of the best and the brightest and the hardest working scientists in the world. But of course, I think as many of you know, most of what we do fails. And occasionally, one of our molecules overcomes all the many hurdles of drug development and makes it to the market and is able to help patients. And we're thankful for when that happens. I'm fortunate to be one of the few that has made a molecule that has succeeded in this way. But really what I want to do is to accept this award on behalf of the many scientists in my industry who will never have this opportunity. They work just as hard. Their molecules don't make it. But their desire and the desire of everybody in my industry really is to bring life-saving medications to patients in need. And so it's really on behalf of all those scientists that I accept this award. Thank you.
It looks simple, doesn't it? The Prado Research Award will be introduced by S. Lawrence Sapersky, Chair of the Selection Committee.
Well, I am delighted to present this year's Prado Research Award to Catherine Dulac of Harvard University. Catherine has made central contributions to our understanding of the brain and behavior, from discovering pheromone receptors and how they signal, to uncovering complex mechanisms of gene regulation in the brain, and to dissecting the neural pathways regulating the control of sex-specific social behaviors. She has radically changed our views of how pheromones regulate behavior. Her studies support the important idea that gender-specific behaviors form and persist in both the male and female brain, and these are modulated by experience and other inputs. Catherine's work is ambitious and technically exceptional. It combines experimental creativity and deep biological insight. It is thus a great pleasure to present this year's Prado Research Award to Catherine Dulac for her pioneering contributions to the molecular biology of pheromone signaling in mammals and discoveries of neural mechanisms underlying sex-specific social behaviors, including mating, aggression, and parenting.
I feel very humbled and very honored to be this year recipient of the Prado Award, and I wish to express all my gratitude to the National Academy of Sciences and to the member of the selection committee for recognizing our work. I'm in debt to a lot of people who contributed to my education and enabled me to reach my dream of becoming a scientist and perform scientific research. First, my parents, from whom I acquired the love of knowledge and the curiosity for the unknown. Then my excellent teachers, from whom I discovered the wonders of biology and neurobiology. I want also to give a special thank to my former PhD and postdoctoral mentors, Nicole Ledouarin and Richard Axel, who taught me not only the highest rigor, but also how much fun science can be. I also want to thank my colleagues in and outside Harvard. I want to thank my close friends who know that science can have a lot of ups and a lot of downs as well. Finally and foremost, I want to acknowledge the great contribution of a set of exceptionally creative and fun present and former lab members. Our discoveries resulted from a very hard work, a collective effort, but there was also great joy, great enjoyment during what is a really exciting ongoing scientific journey. Thank you very much.
The National Academy of Sciences Award for Scientific Discovery, which I mentioned earlier is a new award this year, will be introduced by Bruce Alberts, Chair of the Selection Committee. Bruce?
Well, it's a pleasure to have this opportunity to present the first ever award for scientific discovery. We had a great committee, mostly made up of young Academy members from a wide variety of disciplines. Our job was to identify the most important breakthrough in the fields of chemistry, biochemistry, or biophysics in the past 5 years. So we spent a lot of time trying to figure out what in the past 5 years meant, because as we all know, science is a continuous activity that builds upon the work of others. And we came up with a definition we hope will serve future committees, that the discovery made in the last 5 years should be now incorporated into any elementary textbook that is written on the subject or in that field. But previous to that discovery, it would not have been in such a textbook. So that was our way to approach this problem. As you know, we chose Jonathan S. Weissman in the end, and as you could read in the program, we chose him for his 2009 development of ribosome profiling, a powerful technique that makes possible genome-wide analysis of protein synthesis in living cells at high resolution, and for its subsequent use to reveal many unanticipated critical molecular insights concerning the process whereby RNA sequences are translated into protein sequences. When I was a student, we used to think that all regulation of gene regulation was carried out at the first step of making an RNA molecule, but now we know that life is much more complicated than that, and thanks to Jonathan's techniques, we're beginning to understand a great deal more about that wonderful entity, the cell. So it's a pleasure to introduce Jonathan.
I'm deeply honored to receive the first Scientific Discovery Award, and I want to take this time to thank the many people in my lab and now around the world who have contributed to ribosome profiling, but especially Nick and Golia. I also want to thank my wife, Jacina, my daughter, Anna, who have put up with many hours at work and many more hours distracted at home as I thought about these. It took 66 years for humanity to go from the 120-foot flight at Kitty Hawk to the moonshot, but only 50 years to go from the determination of the structure of the double helix to deciphering the human genome. And like the moonshot, the Human Genome Project has inspired a generation of scientists, myself included. So I hope that ribosome profiling, by letting us watch how proteins are made in space and time, will help contribute to the effort to decipher the information that's encoded in these genomes and to use this information to both advance basic science and health.
Now, our final presentation will be the National Academy of Sciences Public Welfare Medal, and it will be introduced by our Home Secretary, Professor Susan Wessler. Thank you very much, Susan.
The 2015 National Academy of Sciences Public Welfare Medal is awarded to astrophysicist, cosmologist, author, and science communicator Neil deGrasse Tyson, who is the Frederick P. Rose Director of the Hayden Planetarium of the American Museum of Natural History. The Public Welfare Medal, which was established in 1914, is the highest honor of the National Academy of Sciences and is presented annually by the Council of the Academy in recognition of distinguished contributions in the application of science to the public welfare. The citation for Neil deGrasse Tyson reads as follows: for his extraordinary role in exciting the public about the wonders of science from atoms to the universe. And for this award, both the presenter gets a little bit extra time to go into some more, and the speaker, so I want him to speak, so this will be shorter. So Neil Tyson is a native New Yorker. He is a graduate of the Bronx High School of Science, and I say that because that's also my high school. And also the high school of 8 Nobel laureates in physics and chemistry, which I think he mentioned was more than most countries in this world. He received his bachelor's degree in physics from Harvard, his PhD in astrophysics from Columbia University. In 1995, he took over directorship of the Hayden Planetarium, where he played a key role in the design of the world-class Rose Center for Earth and Science. He hosted NOVA Origins on PBS, was executive producer of NOVA Science Now for several seasons, and most recently, last year, he served as executive editor and host for Cosmos, a space-time odyssey, a 13-episode Emmy-nominated primetime series that aired on Fox Network and was broadcast in 181 countries in 45 languages via the National Geographic Channel. He's also the host of Star Talk Radio, which is a podcast devoted to all things space, and I have part of my commute to Riverside. I download that podcast, and it's made my ride more enjoyable. He also, just this week, last week, was the television show that arose from Star Talk Radio. The Star Talk television program had its premiere last week on the National Geographic Channel. Among his numerous awards and honors, he is a recipient of 18 honorary doctorates and NASA's Distinguished Public Service Medal, the agency's highest honor for non-government citizens. His coolest honor, at least in my opinion, was the official naming of asteroid 131123 Tyson by the International Astronomical Union in recognition of his contributions to the public appreciation of the cosmos. Relevant to the one story that I will tell is that he has appeared on the Colbert Report a record 12 times and on Jon Stewart's Daily Show 9 times. I listened to a recent interview, it was a year ago, from Fresh Air with Dave Davies, who was substituting for Terry Gross. And in it, Davies asks, when did you realize you had a gift for communicating with people about science? And Tyson said, yeah, people call it a gift. And that implies you sit there and someone hands it to you. I want to encourage people to not think in terms of gifts, but in terms of wow. You work hard to succeed at that, because that's exactly what I do. For an example, before my first interview on Jon Stewart, you know, that guy's a tough interview because he's brilliant and he's laden with pop culture referencing. And so I said to myself, if I'm going to have a successful interview with Jon Stewart, I want to study how he talks to his guests. So I sat there and I timed how long he lets you speak before he comes in with some kind of wisecrack or a joke. And what's the average time interval of that? Is it 90 seconds, a minute, 30 seconds? And I would create a rhythm in the parceling of the information I would deliver to him so that a complete thought would come out. So that when he does interrupt, there's a complete thought and then a fun joke. And then there's a resonance to that where you can move on. Yeah, no, it's not a gift. And I think you could tell from the applause that this audience of scientists knows better than perhaps any audience you have spoken to that what you do is hard. We know this because most of us have tried and failed, or at best have enjoyed a modicum of success. In contrast, you have been spectacularly successful. Before I end, I just want to say two things. First of all, I want to thank your family for sharing you with the world, for the sacrifices they continue to make, your wife, Alice Young, your son and daughter, Travis and Miranda, and your wife and son are here today. Second, I want to end with a passage from the nomination letter in terms of the impact of what you're doing. Tyson has been and will continue to be an extraordinary voice and face for science in the U.S. and around the world. In this time when science is increasingly misunderstood, or worse yet, under attack, Neil deGrasse Tyson speaks to the broad public in a language they understand and through the media that they use to explain and demystify science, share the excitement of its amazing discoveries, ultimately increasing the public understanding and support of science. He is truly the Carl Sagan of the 21st century and a singularly appropriate recipient of the U.S. National Academy's Public Welfare Medal. Okay.
Delighted to see many of my astrophysics colleagues in the audience. Thanks for being here, and take that as a sign of support. Many of them knew me as a graduate student and as a postdoc, and my professional trajectory has been unorthodox, but nonetheless rewarding, which is a kind of an existence proof that not all pathways have to have been taken before. There are some other pathways available that you can carve out. I have an unorthodox view of awards. One might even say it's contrarian. The awards tend to, the shorthand, really, for others to congratulate you for the work you've done. But I would rather be congratulated for your accomplishments rather than for the award given for the accomplishments. And there are interesting examples of this. Consider, for example, in 1939, the films Citizen Kane and Wizard of Oz were released. These are two of the most famous films ever made. And we know them not because they won Academy Award for Best Picture, Oscar for Best Picture. In fact, they didn't. Neither did. Citizen Kane won an Academy, an Oscar for Best Screenplay. The Wizard of Oz won for Best Song and Best Music. Didn't even get the Oscar for Best Special Effects. You'd think it should be that, right? But it wasn't that. The film that won for Best Special Effects is that unforgettable film called The Rains Came. Remember that one? Yeah, that one got the best special effects. So the award you get and whether you get remembered for something don't always correlate. But I think in the end, you'd rather be remembered for what you've achieved and without the award serving as a destination. The film that did win Best Picture that year was Gone with the Wind. Deservedly, for sure, but Clark Gable didn't get Best Actor. That went to the unforgettable performance of Robert Donat. Okay. In another film, 1935, film buffs know the film It Happened One Night. That's only one of three films ever to win Best Picture, Best Director, Best Actor, and Best Actress. Yet that one doesn't rise up, except perhaps among film buffs. It doesn't rise up as one of the films we remember most in the repertoire. I think, of course, that's a different Academy. I had the urge to tell people this weekend I was winning an Academy Award. But I didn't. I think, for example, the Nobel Prize has similar issues such as this. We have a statue of Albert Einstein out front. I don't know any conversation that involves Einstein among anybody, where at any time in that conversation, someone rushes in and says, "Did you know he won a Nobel Prize?" How irrelevant is that fact, given his actual achievements that we do remember and that we do know? In fact, by my measure, since the Nobel Prize is not a career award, it's for specific achievements, by my measure, he deserved at least five separate Nobel Prizes. My picks would be a Nobel Prize for Brownian motion, establishing the existence of atoms, something that we presumed were there, but we needed some very good understanding of how and why that would be the case. For the photoelectric effect, separate award for that, demonstrating that light exists in quantized energy states. For special relativity, for general relativity, one of the crowning achievements of the human mind in any century. I would also throw in a little known paper on the stimulated emission of radiation. If that were the only thing he did in life, that's what he'd be most famous for. But now it's almost a footnote in his career, but in fact, that is what established. That's what made it possible for us to even think about inventing the laser. We don't think of Einstein when we think of lasers. You should. Yet people win the Nobel Prize, you haven't heard of and wouldn't necessarily have known their work, and those people might tend to lead with their Nobel Prize. So the Nobel Prize is proxy for whatever else they might have done. Some people are known for the Nobel Prize. Some people are known for their work that happened to get a Nobel Prize. This kind of also applies to prestigious schools. There are people who attend prestigious schools. And in their lives, that becomes what they lead with. But if they've ever accomplished something important, then the school becomes less relevant, and what they accomplished is what you'd lead with. So this is kind of it's a quandary, actually, with awards, because awards are feel good to receive them. I won't deny that. It's just that on my deathbed, I don't want people to say he won this award or that award. It'd be nicer if people remembered what I actually did. And so I feel like I'm in slow motion here, because I actually had a long night. I was at the White House Correspondents' Dinner. That could take a lot out of you just watching that unfold. sorry. It's your town here in Washington. In my field, astrophysics, our highest award is the Russell Lectureship, the highest award we give, the American Astronomical Society. And I remember distinctly looking at the history of those winners. And I went down the list, and I said, yep. Every person on that list you've heard of. We know who, I've studied their work. There was a correspondence between my knowledge of their work, how important their work was, how much everybody knew about their work, and the fact they got the highest award. Which means they don't have to lead on their resume with, I won the Russell Lectureship, because their work precedes them. When I think of the National Academy of Sciences, I don't think of a body of accomplished scientists. Although, of course, most academic science departments will list how many academy members there are in their departments, in their universities, as a point of prestige, as a point of pride, as a point of honor. This helps you recruit any next generation of scientists. How many National Academy members are in your department? I don't think of the National Academy that way. A point that's been made several times already this evening. I think of service when I think of the National Academy. The federal charter doesn't say collect a club of smart scientists who can put the membership on their CV and be coveted by those who are not members, be praised by university deans. No. The charter says create an academy of sciences that can serve the government, can guide policy, who can lead a nation into the future. In that sense, membership in the academy is a duty, not an honor, duty. I see this public service award, the highest you give in recognition of my service. I receive it warmly. But like I said, in the end, it's the details of my service for which I'd want to be remembered, and not for the award itself. I want to shift gears briefly and read for you. There's purpose in this. Just hang with me, I promise. I read for you Abraham Lincoln's Gettysburg Address. I can tell you in advance it's 272 words, so you can sit there for that long. 87 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a large sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here have consecrated it, far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here. He got that wrong, by the way. But he can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from those honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government by the people, of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from this earth. It's Abraham Lincoln, November 19th, 1963. I read this because 2 years ago, I got a phone call from the Abraham Lincoln Library Foundation. And they asked me, would I mind composing 272 words of my own, reflecting on the Gettysburg Address, the time, the place, the presidency, the war, slavery, anything that I might that might stimulate my urges to write such a speech. And I say, you've got the wrong person. I'm an astrophysicist. Why are you asking me this? They asked it of several dozen people, maybe as many as 50, including former presidents, you know, notable political types, Colin Powell, folks like that. And I said, I got nothing to say. I'm not a Civil War reenactor. I'm not an expert in the era. I don't know that I can contribute to this volume that you are creating. So I said, let me sleep on it over the weekend. And I did, and I woke up Monday morning and I said, I know what I'm going to do. And I did it. I wrote 272 words. And I think I may be the only scientist in this collection. I haven't seen every single name. Most of them are politicians and others who affect policy. An added requirement was that after I submitted my 272 words, I had to handwrite the speech, just as President Lincoln did. So I was honored to do so because I own feather pens and fountain pens. It's a hobby of mine. And thus it was submitted. This month, the volume of all of these speeches of the 50 of us or so, was just published by the Abraham Lincoln Library Foundation. And it's called Gettysburg Replies. I'm going to read you what I wrote. The seedbed. One and a half centuries ago, Civil War divided these United States of America. Yet in its wake, we would anneal as one nation indivisible. During the bloody year of his Gettysburg Address, President Lincoln chartered the National Academy of Sciences, comprised of 50 distinguished American researchers, whose task was then, as now, to advise Congress and the executive branch of all the ways the frontier of science may contribute to the health, wealth, and security of its residents. As a young nation, just 47 years old, we had plucked the engineering fruits of the Industrial Revolution that had shaped Europe. But Americans had yet to embrace the meaning of science to society. Now, with more than 2,000 members, the National Academy encompasses dozens of fields undreamt of at the time of Lincoln's charter. Quantum physics, discovered in the 1920s, now drives nearly one-third of the world's wealth, forming the basis for our computer revolution in the creation, storage, and retrieval of information. And as we continue to warm our planet, climatology may be our only hope to save us from ourselves. During the centennial of its charter, President Kennedy, a photo of him about to address this audience hangs in the corridor. During the centennial of its charter, President Kennedy addressed the Academy membership, noting, "The range and depth of scientific achievement in this room constitutes the seedbed of our nation's future. In this, the 21st century, innovations in science and technology form the primary engines of economic growth. While most remember Honest Abe for war and peace and slavery and freedom, the time has come to remember him for setting our nation on a course of scientifically enlightened governance, without which we may all perish from this earth. Thank you all."